Well, my name is Greg Washington. I'm the Dean of the Samueli School of Engineering here at UCI, and I want to welcome you all to our Ingenuity Student 2019 UCI Student Technology Showcase. It is a great event. This is the seventh year of this event, and really we're here to do three things. One, we'll hear a keynote address from one of our top technology company leaders, and this year we have Experian Consumer Services here with us today. We will recognize some influential individuals that have helped both schools continue to produce some of the best students, not just in Orange County, not just in California, but in the whole country. And lastly, we will prove this to you by having the students highlight some of the projects that they've been developing over this past year, and we always look forward to that. We couldn't have an event like this without the help of some really, really dedicated people. I always like to say, if you see a frog at the top of a flagpole, you know he didn't get there by himself. And to put on an event like this takes some people jumping really high, most of which is Kristen Hirth. Where is Kristen? Please give Kristen a round of applause. And so we really thank you all for taking a little bit of time to spend with us today. We have a lot to cover, and so I'm going to jump right into it. First, I will introduce our keynote speaker, Jennifer Leuer. So Jennifer holds an MBA from the University of California, Irvine, go Anteaters, and a BA from Cal State University, Fullerton. We don't hold that against them. She is president of Experian Consumer Services Partner Solutions Business Unit, which enables partners to acquire new and high-value relationships with their customers. She recently led a $300 million acquisition and integration of CSID. Through this integration, she unified CSID with Experian's data breach and affinity businesses, which are now collectively known as Partner Solutions. During her tenure, Jennifer has been instrumental in the creation and growth of consumer services, launched multiple products, led two acquisition integrations, which are accountable for creating membership retention and growth strategies across multiple businesses. Jennifer is a passionate mentor, and she's been engaged not just with individuals at Experian, but also individuals in the community as well. She works with Experian's Business Network and the Women in Experian programs, and she's also an executive sponsor of Experian's partnership with the UCI Mirage School of Management. We're really excited to have Jennifer here with us tonight, and so please, without any further ado, Jennifer Leuer.
It's a pleasure to be here, and when the dean asked me to join you this evening, I was thrilled for a couple reasons. The first is I have a real affinity for the Samueli School, and that's because of a program called Fab Camp. And for those of you who are not familiar with Fab Camp, it's actually a program for middle schoolers who are interested in engineering. And my son, who's with me tonight in the back row, I'm going to embarrass my 14-year-old, actually attended twice, and it was a really formative experience for him. He went in really cemented on robotics, and he came out interested in chemical engineering, mechanical engineering, and he even got his first soldering burn here in the chemical or in the electrical engineering lab, which he proudly talks about. So he wants to know if the next time he does it, if you're going to blow stuff up. So that's actually a request of his, but it's been a great experience for him. The other reason why I was thrilled is this gives me an opportunity to share some lessons that I didn't learn in school. So Mirage was a great program. I learned about finance, I learned about strategy, operations, marketing. And when I got out and started taking on greater leadership roles, I realized I had a lot more to learn about how to drive innovation and ingenuity in organizations. So that's what we're going to talk a little bit about tonight. So as you heard from my background, I've lived in your world of technology and engineering, but I'm not of it. So I'm more of a generalist in what I'm good at. I tend to be on the subjective side of the business. So I spend a lot of time setting vision and strategy. I'm out with clients looking at what the market needs are. And I'm also leading teams and really trying to inspire the organization and create a culture for ingenuity. And that's increasingly more important and a bigger part of my time, because as the pace of change continues to increase, organizations, teams, and people who can really think creatively and bring ingenuity through on a day-to-day basis, not just in special projects, are incredibly valuable, both in organizations as well as in society. So I love being in a room with ingenious souls. That's what I call engineers. So I will submit a few things to you tonight that I hope will aid you, both as you go into your next roles or for those of you who are here supporters of the school in your current roles. So this is an expansive topic. We could be here for 3 days. We could be here for 3 hours. I was thinking I could probably do this in 2.5 hours. Does that sound good? No, I know. You guys want to see the students. That's why you came, right? There's some amazing projects. So I'll keep it to 20 minutes. I've picked 5 of my kind of ingenuity lessons learned to share with you for your consideration today. So the first one is ingenuity is about iteration, not epiphanies. So when I started, I had this movie playing in my head of people sitting in offices doing big thinking. And maybe they were on a whiteboard and suddenly the light bulb goes on over their head and bam, they have the next $1 million idea and the team comes in and they execute it and they're off to the races. And so I had my morning time set aside where my morning creative time is when I blow dry my hair because I can't do anything else. And I was getting really frustrated because I wasn't having any epiphanies. And at the time I was working on an online real estate transaction platform. And what we were trying to do is change the way that you and I buy and sell real estate. So we wanted to take the agent out of it and bring it on, make it an online transaction, which is really tough work. And we were making some changes and we were having some good progress, but we weren't really getting there fast enough in my mind. So you can call this a breakthrough because of a breakdown, because I went into my boss and I said, hey, I don't know what we're doing. This isn't working. I think we're trying to take the wrong path. And he looked at me and he said, I have some homework for you. And I thought, oh gosh, I thought I was over homework. And he said, I want you to go home and I want you to watch Touching the Void. So I thought, oh, a movie, I can do that. So went home and I proceeded to watch this movie about two mountain climbers who scale this peak in the Himalayas. And on the descent, one of them falls and breaks their leg. And apparently in mountain climbing culture, when that occurs, you're basically, it's a death sentence. And so, yeah, this is a really exciting movie. So his partner tries to get him down. He falls into a cave. And at that point, you think this guy is done for. But you know he survives because he's talking in this film. And so he spends this torturous night wondering, you know, what it's going to feel like to die. And the sun comes up in the morning and he says, you know what? The sheer enormity of trying to survive this was too much for me to grok. I couldn't see how this was going to work. But I knew I had to get out of the cave. I knew that if there was one thing I could do, it was just to get out of the cave. So he gets out of the cave somehow. He's laying on the snow and he sees a rock and he says, I think I can make it to that rock. And his story is one of 2 days of incrementally going down the mountain until ultimately he makes it down. And it really was a powerful story around the importance of incrementalism. When sometimes there's something ahead of you that is too much, it just seems too much. Break it down into those chunks and really focus on the next increment. So I went back in, shared the story with the team, and we went on over the next year to make a series of iterative changes to the platform and ultimately sold several hundred homes online, which was really our goal. And to this day, I still have my little Lego mountain climber on my desk to remind me that it's not about the epiphanies. It's really about the grit of working through the iterative cycle of innovation. And when you can do that, that's where the big payoffs come. So the important example or the important word that I used in that example was team. And sometimes, you know, we think that individual geniuses are the ones that are about innovation. And for those of you who are Big Bang Theory fans out there, I don't know if you remember the episode where it's the physics bowl and Sheldon decides that he doesn't need a team and ultimately is bested by his roommates and his nemesis because he tried to do it alone. And I think this is a great example of the fact that a committed team will always outperform a single genius. Now at Experian, we have a less colorful way of doing this, but it's still a great outcome, which is we've, over the last few years, really focused on incentivizing teams and businesses to collaborate together to use their unique capabilities and data to create an outcome that is really differentiated in the marketplace. So how can I take your peanut butter and my chocolate and make something really new and different? And so before I get into this great outcome of those efforts, I'll talk a little bit about Experian. So we're the global, you probably know us as the credit bureau, which we are, and that's a big part of our business. We're actually the global leader in both consumer and business credit monitoring, or excuse me, credit reporting and monitoring. And then we also have a very large data and marketing services business. In North America, which is the largest division of Experian, we cut across financial services, automotive, health, and marketing technology segments. We have about 17,000 employees in 37 countries, and we service clients in 80 countries. So we get a lot of great information in various markets that we can bring in and look at products and services that'll help consumers and businesses across multiple markets. We've grown through acquisition as well as innovation, and there's been a big focus over the last few years, again, to really focus on how can we use data for good and how can we use the unique parts of the business to create something new in the marketplace. So many of you have probably seen, there's been a lot of advertising recently on our newest product, which is called Experian Boost. The concept here is that I, as a consumer, can add my data to my credit file, and it, in the majority of cases, will boost my credit score, which I think is a product we all can get behind, right? That's something that I want, is a higher credit score. And what was interesting is this is a big idea. I mean, this is a major change in our industry, the idea that I can actually put data on my credit file that I want people to see. But it was not simple, and it did not come from a single mind. So this was an idea that had been floating around. People had thought about how can we open up the credit files and put the power in the consumer's hands. But there is significant work that needed to go on behind the scenes. It was not a few small database changes. So ultimately, we had over 200 employees working on this across three different businesses. It was countless hours and months of work that went into this product. And I think what's really interesting is we had 400 people in 30 different states who tested it. So 400 employees said, hey, I want to test that. I want to be part of the innovation, even if I have nothing to do with the engineering of the database side of it. And they were able to provide feedback and explain how they thought the consumer experience could be improved. So that was actually a really wonderful point in the business. We have almost 1,000 people working on one of the best new products that we've put out. So the teams actually had to develop technology to identify payments that qualify to go on the file, which includes telco and utility data. And then they had to figure out a way to update the credit file real time, which was used to be sort of a batch process. And then ultimately they had to figure out how to score it immediately. So when the consumer had added their data, they got the payoff of the score. And in talking with the team, it was really interesting. So they said, you know, yes, there were personal epiphanies, if you will, along the way. People had the ability to sort of say, hey, I figured out a way to get over that problem. But really where they found the innovation was most rich was in the collaboration and the challenge sessions that they had to create this product. So what they would say is no single genius made this happen. There were 700 geniuses that made it happen. The other thing that they noted and that I wanted to underscore here is the importance of diversity. So those teams were incredibly diverse. And when I mean when I use the word diverse, I mean they brought diversity of thought. They brought diversity of background, of gender, of race, of ethnicity, of style and communication style. And what we've found at Experian, and not all companies embrace diversity. Not all companies are excited about inclusion, but what we found is when you're bringing in people with a different viewpoint, with prior knowledge that you don't have, it creates a richer environment. We all like people who are like ourselves, but that can be a little single-minded. And so when we bring people into the organization and then ask them to participate and include them in discussions and projects and really pull them out, it leads to a much richer environment. We started, as part of our inclusion efforts a couple years ago, a movement called The Power of You. And it's in 7 or 8 employee resource groups. And really the goal there was to encourage employees to bring their whole selves to work. The idea was we want you to come as you are and bring all of your gifts. What has happened over the last 2 years has been measurable and marked in terms of the impact that it's had. We've had greater cultural awareness, for sure, and we have some wonderful celebrations. I got to participate in a Diwali celebration that was truly touching. We've also, though, seen that our employees are engaged at a different level, and some of this is coming through in innovation. So we have employees who migrated here, who are passionate about unbanked consumers and are volunteering to work on projects around how we open lending to unbanked consumers. We have employees of all genders who are assisting us with how we start thinking about mentoring and assisting them with their leadership tracks. They want to see more people like them in executive leadership roles, and they're willing to come to the table and talk about how they're different and what they need. We have a Women in Experian initiative, as Greg talked about, that has really provided the women in Experian with an opportunity to talk about how they're different and how they're strong. And I had a wonderful conversation with a colleague recently who said she hadn't realized how much energy she was spending trying to fit in the organization. And through these conversations and just through talking about diversity and inclusion and really encouraging it, she started to shed some of those concerns that she had. She stopped trying to be confident and through that process became more self-confident. She embraced the fact that she was an influencer style versus command and control. And she took all that energy that she'd been using to sort of fit in, and now has started thinking about, as a single mom, how can I create products and services that are going to solve unique needs that I see in the marketplace? And so we see that across the board. We've had several different initiatives where we've had people that are involved in The Power of You come to innovation sessions and talk specifically about their unique experiences and how the business needs to be doing more to assist different groups that they have ownership with. So, I think that, in short, empowering and getting individuals excited through these types of inclusion initiatives and diversity initiatives has a real payoff, not for just the individuals and the teams, but actually the business. So the next learning is an aha for me, but it's also a challenge for you. And it was really interesting talking with some of the students about this one. So, my challenge to you is, when is the last time you were out with a customer, a consumer, or a client? You're going to hear from the team that did the sign language translation glove, and they were testing it in the center where they got the idea, which is really powerful because they got new information that they would then use to iterate from it. But a lot of times we think that we've got our idea and it's perfect and we're just going to build it. But it's really about the customer. So this is a quote from Peter Drucker. You've probably all seen it. I argue that this is the foundation of innovation. So the purpose of a business is not to create revenue or profit. Like, what? I'm glad my boss isn't here because he would say, what? The purpose of a business is to create a customer, and you create a customer by filling a need. And you understand the customer's need by speaking with them. So you also can fill a need once, but if you're not out talking with them again and again, their needs may change and your competitor may come in and fill those needs if you're not staying in touch with them. So I like to give an overly simplistic example of Wi-Fi on airplanes. When I got on an airplane the first time and I had Wi-Fi, it was like, boom, this was amazing. Suddenly, I could do online shopping 10,000 feet in the air and check email and do some work and stay connected and all that good stuff, but it was really about the shopping. So it was a great experience. And then the next time I got on, suddenly my need had changed. It was a little slow. You know, the pages weren't loading as much as they were on the ground. It's a very simplistic example, but it shows that as people sort of get used to the innovation, they have new needs, and I wanted something that was approximated the experience that I would have at home while I was on the airplane if I was going to pay $20 for that. Now, I have great conversations with engineers all the time, and they come in and they're very excited about new products and services, and my answer is generally the same, which is, let's go talk to a client. Some of them are really excited about that, and some of them look at me like I'm asking them to run out in the hallway in their underwear. And I will tell you that the best, oh, I don't want to fall off the stage here. The best meetings that I have with clients are the ones where the engineers are present. Because they ask great questions, and they understand the business in a way that not everyone else does. In fact, usually the salespeople just kind of are quiet and let the engineers run the meeting when they're there. So there's a lot of value in getting in front of the client. And what we find is, not only is it a better meeting, but the solution that someone had come forward with ends up being richer and better because the customer was giving them more input, and it allowed them to kind of pivot a little bit or iterate a little bit more and make it a better product idea. So the last learning is probably one of the toughest, at least for me. As you get into leadership roles, you talk more and listen less, and it's supposed to be the other way around. So I think we're often conditioned to feel the need to have all the answers. But really, the power is in the question. And my favorite book is Good Leaders Ask Great Questions by John Maxwell. And in it, he actually talks about two things. I think one just bears 60 seconds, which is you do not have to have, to be a leader, you do not have to have a team reporting to you. That is not what leadership is about. Leadership ultimately is about influence in teams and in organizations. And so when we use these words like leader, people say it's not them, but really some of the best leaders I've ever known are chief scientists or individual contributors who are heavy, heavy influencers in organizations. The second thing he talks about is the power of asking questions and really, really listening, active listening. Questions like, what do you think? What do we need to know? What am I missing? These are all really powerful ways to get more information and enrich ideation. I had a formative experience early on in my career where I was in a brainstorm meeting. I was a junior employee. There were lots of senior leaders. And we started going down this path that I thought had a lot of risks. And I was a little nervous, so I didn't say much. And there was a hole in the conversation, and I plunged in and I asked a question about some risks. What were the risks associated with this? And that generated some meaty conversation. And then I asked another question, a follow-up question. And there was some more great conversation. And the leader who was sitting next to me turned to me and he said, hey, great questions. Keep it up, Jen. And the next thing that popped into my head was, really? But I kept that one to myself and I just smiled. Said, yeah. And that, to me, I realized I can bring value even if I don't know the answer. I can bring value without telling. I can bring value by asking and being inquisitive. So now in my notebook, I have a little statement, and every time I change notebooks, I rewrite it, and it says, ask questions, then opine. So ask the questions first, then give your opinion. I also have been doing a lot of reading on Zen philosophy lately, and there's this concept of beginner's mind. And as I was preparing for today, I thought, you know what? It's beginner's mind, but it's also engineer's mind. So I would encourage you to embrace beginner's mind or engineer's mind when you're in innovation opportunities. So these were a few ahas for your consideration. Brain science generally holds that if you use information in 24 to 48 hours, it'll stick. So if there was something in here that popped the light bulb on over your head, please use it. We are always constantly learning. You know, if we did this in a year, I would probably have a few others that I would replace these with. And I would love to engage with you and learn more about what you think about Ingenuity. So this is my LinkedIn if you want to connect with me, and I'll be around after. But I thank you very much for having me here today, and congratulations to all the students who are presenting, and all the best to you. Thank you.
Please give another round of applause to Jennifer. Thank you, Jennifer. Good evening, everyone. My name is Marius Papaefthymiou. I'm the Dean for the Donald Bren School of Information and Computer Sciences. I'm up here to start the second part of the program, the Ingenuity Awards. These awards are given to some of the most dedicated and influential individuals in our community who have been tremendous, who have had tremendous impact on our schools. Our awardees have been generous, not only with material resources, but also with the most precious resource of all, their time, helping in the direction and growth of our academic programs. It's my great pleasure and indeed an honor to introduce this year's ICS Ingenuity Award recipient, Vince Steckler. Vince holds two bachelor's degrees from ICS, one in mathematics, which is okay, and one in information and computer science, which is fabulous. Vince is the CEO, Chief Executive Officer for Avast Software, and he's also one of Avast's directors. Through his leadership, Avast was transformed from a $20 million per year regional company into a $1 billion per year full service global security provider using next generation technologies to advance its mission of making the internet safe and accessible by protecting the world from cyber attacks. Avast went public at the London Stock Exchange, May of 2018. It was reportedly either the largest or the second largest tech IPO in the history of the London Stock Exchange. And of course, a lot had to do with Vince's leadership at Avast. Before joining Avast, Vince was a VP for Symantec for 8 years. And prior to Symantec, he had 20 years of experience in software development, systems analysis, engineering, project management, and business development. Vince, congratulations. Please join me to the stage to accept your award.
Congratulations, Vince. Give him another round of applause. Next, I'm pleased to share Engineering's Award recipient, Jai Hakhu. Jai holds a Bachelor of Science from J&K University, a Bachelor of Engineering from Indian Institute of Sciences, a master's in solid-state engineering from IIT Roorkee in India, and a PhD in electrical engineering from UC Irvine. He is currently the executive officer, chairman, and CEO of Hariba Instruments Incorporated. Jai has led the partnership between the School of Engineering and Hariba Group in research and educational efforts to combine the formerly disparate energy and transportation sectors into an integrated complementary system under the Advanced Power and Energy Program here at UCI. He has taught at the Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee. He's taught here at UC Irvine, at Cal State Long Beach, and he's lectured at Stanford University and also MIT. Jai is proud to have been inducted into the Engineering Hall of Fame at UCI. Congratulations, Jai. Please join me on the stage to accept your award. Please give Jai another round of applause. I would now like to introduce Dr. Hadar Ziv, who is one of the instructors here at ICS and has been teaching the Capstone Project class for over a decade. And he will now bring us forward with the student presentations. Please welcome Hadar.
Thank you, Dean Washington, and welcome again to this Ingenious event and Ingenious night in one of the top 10 UCs in the state. Thank you. Thank you. This is a good crowd. Thank you. So my name is Hadar Ziv, and I work here, even though after the next 3 minutes, I'm not so sure. I am also an ad-eater and received a PhD from this wonderful institution, and also tenure, so thank you very much. I'm here to introduce the 10 student teams that are going to present. They've been practicing hard and working hard on their projects. Some of them are quarter long, two quarters, sometimes even longer. 5 from the School of ICS and 5 from the School of Engineering. You will see, Jennifer mentioned diversity. You will see diversity of presenters, diversity of presentations, and diversity of topics. You will see some very serious engineering projects, sometimes life and death situations, all the way to fun educational games for cute sea mammals. You will see engines for rockets and multi-wing propeller engines, all the way to a better understanding of sign language, as was also mentioned, and of financial systems. We might even have a surprise appearance of a pop star, but I'm reserving that in the surprise bucket. I'm part of a team of professors that teaches these range of project courses on the ICS side, and there's a similar cadre or pod of professors on the engineering side that teaches those project courses on that side as well. We also have no problem in self-promoting and self-benefiting from student projects. So the first project that you will see is actually serving us, the professors of the project courses, by creating an automated system and a database system to better support our management of student projects for the long term. So without further ado, William from the first team.
Hi, good evening, everybody. My name is William Kane, and on behalf of my teammates from Not Fast, Just Furious, we would like to present ZivBase. And yes, I know what you're thinking. It is named after Professor Ziv. So I want to give a little bit of context. Many of the projects you're about to see tonight are done in the context of project courses offered by the informatics department. Every year, more students continue to be enrolled in these courses, meaning that the behind-the-scenes work in order to provide valuable educational experiences does as well. The professors and the Office of External Relations are becoming more involved. Recruiting and the management of sponsors needs to become more effective and more efficient, and all of the data pertinent to project courses have to be easily accessible. Now, it's these reasons that we created ZivBase. The first component is a web application that operates as an archive of projects, sponsors, teams, and contacts. There's also the ability to track interactions about project opportunities. And because we want this to be kept within the School of Information and Computer Science, we've also included user authorization. Now, there's also a part that's available for everybody, which is the public website. That's where we showcase student talent as well as sponsor history in the hopes that we'll get more engagement from the community in terms of sponsors and projects. Now, we hope that ZivBase will operate as a way to provide future educational experiences for teams in the future. But ZivBase was also a way for us to receive educational experience and insights. The first was the value of communication. We coordinated consistently and constantly in order to prioritize requirements and plan implementations, not only between ourselves, but also with our stakeholders. Communication was also necessary in order to navigate through a pivot point that happened about halfway through the project. We also embraced the agile development process for software engineering, in which we iterated not only over tool sets, but we refined our requirements in order to deliver a viable product. And finally, we realized that utilizing full stack solutions required fully aware teams. We learned a lot of what we did on the fly, meaning that we had to keep each other well informed, not only to build up the application, but also each other's technical skills. Well, that's all the time we have. And if you'd like to learn more about Zivbase, please come by our booth. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Harshita, and my team worked on a glove that can translate sign language into text and speech. The speech and hearing impaired community often face many problems that the average person does not encounter and which most people take for granted. They lack a convenient and accessible means of verbal communication, which forces them to rely on written communication or human translators. They also suffer disadvantages when looking for jobs. Unfortunately, there are currently no similar products in the market that can translate sign language into speech. We decided to tackle these problems by creating a glove that can translate American Sign Language in real time. Our solution removes the intermediary of a human translator and provides the speech and hearing impaired with a more natural form of communication through sign language. The glove provides a portable and convenient solution empowering sign language users. So the glove is powered by an Arduino Lily Pad, 5 flex sensors, 6 contact sensors, and an accelerometer. The flex sensors tell us to what degree each finger is bent, while the contact sensors tell us whether two parts of a glove are touching. Finally, the accelerometer takes into account any motion when using the glove. All of the data from these sensors are then sent via Bluetooth to an iPhone application, which uses a pre-trained model to predict a sign based off of these sensors. This translated sign is then displayed on the app for the user to view. In the future, we hope to expand our model to be able to translate signs from the different sign languages around the world. Thank you for listening, and feel free to stop by our table for a demo.
Good evening, everyone. My name is David Brown. On behalf of my team, team Cerno.UCI, I'll be speaking to you tonight. So over the past two quarters, we've been working with a company named Cerno. They're a small tech startup down in Newport Beach. Cerno describes themselves as more than just a machine learning company. In fact, they're actually changing the way that people communicate with others through their computers in a wide range of industries, everything from sales to mental health. So for our project, we partnered with Cerno, and what we did was we built and designed a way to improve the online customer service experience. The way we did this was we first started by building our own custom, secure, two-way chat. From that point, we then integrated Cerno's sentiment analysis and natural language processing in order to generate actionable data in real time that a user could use when using the system. And what that allowed us to do was to have a more meaningful conversation with the customer and really understand their words and the deeper meaning behind them. So with that being said, I'd like to show you exactly how it works. Our team's created a short demo. So here's what our application looks like. If you were a customer service rep, this is what you would be seeing. On the left-hand side is a very similar looking chat window that many have probably seen before. But the green bubble is the customer service rep. The gray bubble is going to be our customer. Now, as they type, we also made a custom scroll bar in the center. What we wanted to do is not only be able to scroll through the message, but those individual bubbles are clickable, meaning our customer service rep could click through the conversation as need be. But the right side, that's where the magic comes in. That's the actionable data that we're able to generate based upon what the customer is saying. So every time the customer types in a new message in those gray bubbles, we're pulling it and generating a customer profile on the right. Those are different tools that our customer service rep can pull from to match their conversation style or just better understand where they're coming from. So, and that is our demo. Thank you so much for listening. Please come by our booth. We'll have it set up for you.
Imagine your loved one, their head hits the ground, they're knocked out cold. What would you do? Well, you'd rush them over to the ER, and when they present to the doctor, they'll say, okay, let's get a look at him. But the thing is, we have to wait about 2 hours. 2 hours, you ask, why? Well, that's because there exists no device on the market that allows us to get instant insights into the brain. Instead, we have this. It's called an electroencephalogram, also called an EEG. It's used to monitor and diagnose brain conditions. If you've ever seen this device in real life, it's huge. It's as big as me, and they have to pull it room to room. And in fact, there's a technician that's required in order to actually put every electrode individually onto the patient's head. This can take a long time, and that's why they have to wait for 2 long hours, during which every hour which you go undiagnosed for a neural disorder increases your chances of death 2 to 3%. And that's no joke. And neurologists know this. So in case if the patient comes from a long place away from the hospital, they can over-medicate them and put them on life support. However, this can mask the signals from the brain, so they may not even know what's really going on and can misdiagnose them. This is a problem, and we seek to change this. We are going to develop a ultra-portable EEG. It's going to be handheld, a 3-channel, and as well as it's going to have a HIPAA-compliant technology, so security will be good, and it will have a setup time less than 2 minutes at 1/100th of the size. No longer will we be stuck in this huge system that's as big as me that can be put room to room. Instead, it'll be in your hands, and you can do it instantly on the spot. Because now we can save lives, and instead of having to wait 2 hours for a system, we can instead know immediately on the spot what sort of condition is going on and give them the proper treatment. Because sincerely, this is something that was made in the 1980s, and that design still persists until today. Let's move from then. From the 1980s, the portability from as big as me to my hand. Thank you very much, everyone.
That was a little heavy, so now some cute sea mammals.
Hello, everyone. I'm Daniel Nakasone, and I'm a part of SEAL Team 6. And we worked in collaboration with the Pacific Marine Mammal Center to come up with an educational tool to show how the center goes about rehabilitating and rescuing marine mammals that have fallen in poor health along our Southern California shores. So the center does a lot of great work when it comes to rescuing these animals, but they also want to educate its visitors as to what the center actually does and to help promote its activities amongst the community. To that end, they want a way to reach out to kids in order to show how great the center is and how great their work is. To address this concern, we've developed a game that's fairly straightforward, fairly simple to work with, but it provides a fun and very unique experience for kids to really get their hands on and really learn about how the center performs its rehabilitation process along the way. So it lets kids go through the examination, the diagnosis, and the treatment processes, as well as show a little video at the end to see how these processes played out for the real life patients that the center had to treat. As far as the technology that we used, we used Unity, which is a very popular game engine and development platform that is used by major companies as well as game enthusiasts. And we used Photoshop to create the art assets and the animation. A lot of these technologies we had very little experience in. I thought I was a decent artist before I started this project, and then working with it really showed how hard it could be. But it was a very rewarding experience. We got to learn we got to deal with technologies that we weren't accustomed to, and we were able to help the center with its admirable goal. Thank you. Please come by and check us out. I hope you give us your seal of approval.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Adrian Bahani, and I'm with Hemodynamics. Hemodynamics is a biomedical engineering senior design project that is presenting our HemoFlow imager and allows patients to visualize beyond. To give a little background, there are 6.5 million people in the US that suffer from chronic wounds, with diabetic foot ulcers being the worst form of those chronic wounds. Every 30 seconds, a leg is amputated worldwide due to chronic wounds. All this amounts in the US to $39 billion for a total cost burden. Specifically, we have 1 million patients that suffer from diabetic foot ulcers. And the average cost of a diabetic foot ulcer is over about approximately $30,000. Here, we have the diabetic foot ulcer treatment timeline. Foot ulcers monitor grade 0 to 3. Upon grades 2 to 3, you start wound care. And unfortunately, if you go progress to grade 4 and 5, you may lead to amputation or death. And the problem here is the inadequacy with the early diagnosis of diabetic foot ulcers stemming from the shortcomings of visual inspection. Visual inspection is subjective, sometimes reactive, and too late, and requires a lot of expertise to properly diagnose what is actually happening. And it focuses on grade 0 and 1. If grade 0 and 1 can be accurately diagnosed, well, now we can look at this slide and now take a look at price point. For grade 0 and 1, you can a price to treat a patient is up to $4,000. But if you progress down the diabetic foot ulcer grades, you go up to $200,000 per foot. And this is where we come in. Hemodynamics is trying to provide a quantitative objective means through non-invasive imaging, a blood flow map to visualize the underlying microcirculation in all in a handheld and portable format to target these grade 0 and 1 diabetic foot ulcers for accurate diagnosis. Currently, we have an initial mock-up we drafted in October last year. We're currently at our MVP, our minimum viable product, and we have a production mock-up that we're aiming towards by the end of this summer. Our accomplishments to date. We have filed a provisional patent application with the US Patent Office earlier this year. We have over $4,000 in grants from the UCI Applied Innovation and Biomedical Engineering Department. We've been the finalists in the UCI New Venture Competition in both Life Sciences track and the Tech Surge tracks. We are also finalists in the Beal and Butterworth Product Development Competition. And last, we are competing for $15,000 in the 2019 BioEngine Fellowship Award. And with that, we are Hemodynamics, and we're here to improve patients' quality of life. If you have any questions, please see us at our booth. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Carlos, and I came here with Claudia, Parker, Lindsay, and Ramon, and we make up the team Rogue 2. Our sponsor, ID Tech, is an industry leader in payment solutions. So here's our problem. ID Tech customers have thousands of devices, all of which run at the same time spread out all across the world. Also, all of these devices need to be integrated, managed, and maintained. So how can ID Tech help facilitate this sort of device management? Well, our solution was the VivoState Terminal Management System mobile application. I know, it's a mouthful. It gives basic stats about all of your devices at a glance, and you can get detailed information about any specific device that you have enrolled. In a nutshell, it allows for remote management of all of your payment devices and at the same time, it helped facilitate the work of technicians out on the field. Now for a few highlights of our project. First, the dashboard. We use Charts.js to make something that's easy to read, easy to understand, and right to the point. Second, the enrolled device page. So we were able to get the geolocation of the devices by using the built-in web services and also use the camera to be able to scan barcodes of the devices. Lastly, we have the device list page. We use data tables to help with the visualizations, make them look better. We also are able to get real-time updates using data sockets. And lastly, my favorite part, we made the table dynamic because an 8-column table is just not built for mobile. So by making it dynamic, it was just better fit for the mobile environment. It was a hard project. We had some troubles with meeting availability, had to manage the UI design, the preferences of the sponsor, and we also had to work with several other teams. But fortunately, my team and I were able to work together, learn together, and even have a little fun together along the way. Thank you very much, and feel free to come by our booth if you have any questions. We'll be happy to answer them.
Hello, everybody. My name is Nathan Cabza. I will be presenting the multi-wing rotary propulsion engine. That's a mouthful. I'm joined here by my teammate, Fernando Pablo, and our advisor, Motasim Fuda. So if I were to ask you to describe an aquatic vehicle, chances are it would have a propeller blade. Propellers are great at generating thrust. However, they're not without their drawbacks. So propellers are prone to cavitation. This is caused by low pressure areas, and it causes the water to boil. And cavitation creates a number of harmful frequencies. This affects predator-prey interaction, communication, growth, and reproduction for some aquatic species. Also, cavitation reduces the efficiency of a propeller blade and causes excessive wear. So we wanted to address these issues with propellers, and we took a bio-inspired approach to it. So in our lab, we study flapping wings or ornithopter mechanisms. So when we were examining these mechanisms, we found this clapping effect, which created an airburst. We wanted to replicate this airburst in a more scalable engine. So we designed the multi-wing rotary propulsion engine, and it features the 5 clapping wings and 5 fixed wings. So it features passive, flexible, bio-inspired wings, a crank rocker mechanism, and an electric motor. So our prototype, our proof of concept, features all 3D printed components. We made our wings from Kapton and Mylar. We tested both films. And here you can see a GIF of the functional prototype in 1/32nd real-time speed. Ideally, for water applications, we'd have a much slower moving engine, but with better thrust generation. So for future work, we plan on efficiency testing, thrust testing, and frequency testing, and designing a model for water and component optimization. So thank you. Please visit our working prototype demo at the booths. Thanks.
So I am getting word live from Live Nation that we will have a, we will be joined by the superstar performer, Taylor, and the Swifts.
Hi, everyone. I wish I had memorized something like Blank Space or some of the good bops, but this is what I have for you today. So hi, my name's Kristen, or Taylor, and I was a part of team Taylor and the Swifts, and we worked with SendGrid. So SendGrid is an email bounce or custom email delivery service. So they customize and manage subscriptions. So whatever Spotify subscription that you may have had, it sends that email. Now, they send over 45 billion monthly emails, and none of those are spam. Now, that's a lot of emails. So of course, when you have all of those emails and everything going haywire, some of those are going to bounce back. So around 1 million per day bounce back to the they never reach their destination. So they bounce back to the original sender.
So why this happens is called a bounce rule. So there are hundreds and hundreds of different bounce rules that cause kind of this happening. So previously, all of these rules were maintained in the terminal. Now, SendGrid needed a tool that would allow deliverability consultants to properly access the rules and edit them and update everything. So that's where we came in. We created a change management system that would support adding, removing, and modifying rules, as well as tracking changes, being a part of the activity log, and a bunch of cool other stuff. But it really kind of improved the overall look and really gave them the opportunity and ability to move and do more within their application and their company. So some of the new technical skills that we learned were Go, Docker, React, Adobe XD, and Node.js. And within that, we also worked with communicating on many different levels, as well as with a sponsor, with ourselves, and we had a pretty good time. So if you have any questions, go ahead and bounce back to our booth. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Srinath Gopal Krishnan. I'm the incoming chief engineer of the UCI Rocket Project. We're a team of nearly 50 undergraduate students from across the School of Engineering and the School of ICS. The main goal of the UCI Rocket Project is to develop liquid-fueled rockets from scratch. So we're one of nearly or over 30 undergraduate university teams pursuing liquid bipropellant rocketry in the United States. And we're also competing, along with those more than 30 undergraduate teams, in the Base 11 Space Challenge to be the first student team to successfully launch a liquid-fueled rocket to 100 kilometers, which is past the edge of space, and collect the $1 million prize. So in order to achieve this goal, we've designed and manufactured an engine to launch a 120-pound rocket to nearly or above 45,000 feet, utilizing liquid methane and liquid oxygen, both heavily used in the industry. In order to actually test this engine, we've also developed a data acquisition system, a control system, and a support structure to conduct fully instrumented static test fires. This test stand is fully instrumented with more than a dozen sensors to actually compare what happens in real life with the months of calculation that went behind all the design. Right now, the team is in the component testing phase, where we're testing the system for leaks and defects, and as well as testing our assembly procedures, our cleaning procedures, and our actual test procedures. We're also testing our ignition system and how it behaves under pressure and cryogenic conditions. All this testing it's been going on for the past couple of weeks, and we want to be sure that when we go out to the Mojave Desert for actual static test fire, everything goes smoothly, we conduct UCI's first successful static test fire. So in parallel, we're also designing the Base 11 engines and the full-scale rocket for the Space Challenge over the next 2 to 3 years. It's going to be a long, intense couple of months of testing for the team and definitely a long couple of years of design, but I have full faith in my team that we'll conduct UCI's first successful launch, win the Base 11 Space Challenge, and probably do amazing things in the industry. Thank you.
These were some really cool projects and fun presentations. Let's give everyone another round of applause. Many thanks to our students, and obviously many thanks to our faculty who supervise all these fabulous projects. These project courses, by the way, are offered throughout the year. Many of the projects are student-initiated, but many of the projects are sponsored through our industry affiliates. So if you or your company has some ideas about projects, or if you want to be involved with our faculty and our students, please come talk to us. We're all ears, and we're happy to engage, as you saw from today's presentations. This is basically the end of this part of the event. I want to thank everyone for joining us this evening. I want to thank our keynote speaker and our awardees. We look forward to see you again in next year, Ingenuity 2020. And please join us at the patio for a reception and the student demos. I look forward to the student demos. See you all later. Thank you.